Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, I'm very glad to greet you and I'm delighted to present this short message focusing on our beloved founder, servant of God, Father Peter Mary Mermier. I'm talking to you from St. Aldham's Catholic Church here in Malmesbury, England, one of the first parishes to be established by the MSFS in England way back in 1875. We are on the 28th day with Father Mermier, and nearly on the eve of celebrating our Founders' Day. Today I would like to focus on how Father Mermier was a beacon of light in the darkness of his time and thus an inspiration for our modern day. As missionaries of St. Francis de Sales, we often come across people taunting us with this question or asking us, why is your founder not even a blessed yet? While all the other congregations which came later have not only their founder become a saint, but a couple of others as well. Well, it's quite natural to get these type of questions asked or bombarded with. But it is very important to remember that within 7 years of our foundation, out of 10 members, 6 confrères were already sent as missionaries to India, answering the invitation of the Propaganda Fide and responding to the urgency of the mission. Besides that, in 1903, after about 50 years of our foundation, we lost our mother house because of religious persecution in France, and our fathers had to flee Annecy, having all their belongings hurriedly packed and all the archives in disarray, some lost and while others displaced. The two world wars later added fuel to the fire, and these unfortunate events never permitted us to consolidate ourselves as we would have wished, perhaps. In addition to all of this, our founder himself, Father Mermier, never thought he needed to be the center of attention, always on the mission of preparing missionaries and sending them out to India, responding to the urgency of the call. The missionaries had nothing else in mind except mission and people who needed them the most, to bring the light of Christ to those buried in ignorance and darkness. It was the Second Vatican Council's call to go back to the sources, and later in the 1980s, when Father Adrian Duval was a superior general, commissioning to gather and compile the letters written by Father Mermier, that invigorated us towards a renewed interest in our founder. Having initiated the cause of sainthood for Father Mermier in 1990s and reinitiated again in 2019, which died down during the interim period, we have brought the cause forward now and we are nearly at the end of the diocesan phase. We all pretty much know that Father Mermier was not a man of eloquence or rhetoric, but was a man of conviction, fervor, zeal in their highest form. He probably didn't possess the flowery language or great outbursts, sublime flights of oratory, and all that goes to make a man, a preacher, more popular and admirable. Well, if he possessed all of these, would he have become more successful or more popular? Probably yes. But then Father Mermier was convinced deeply that that's not what was needed for God's work and evangelization. Even if he had to pursue on that direction, he knew well the mission would have never gained depth. Father Metral, the parish priest of Maglan, where Father Mermier went to preach a mission, seems to have judged him well when after a sermon which Father Mermier preached in his parish, he wrote, "This man of God, who had no other eloquence than that of simplicity, lucidity and conviction, has attracted a greater number of listeners to his instructions." The only desire which inspired and guided Father Mermier and his work was the good of souls in view of their eternal salvation. Jean Rey writes in his book, "If the appearance of Father Mermier at the pulpit seemed to be severe, a warm heart nevertheless beat within him. Three loves made his words efficacious and appealing. Firstly, the love of the truth he preached, secondly, the love of the form which clothed it, and thirdly, the love of the audience who listened to him. These three loves inflamed his gaze, modulated his voice, regulated his gestures, and stressed his convictions. One of his nephews said once, my uncle was not a man of eloquence, but a man of faith, an organizer. He was a very practical man, and all that he did was marked with the stamp of good administration. Father Mermier was convinced of the fact of the scripture that he was of chosen people, of God's very special possession, of royal priesthood. Now we know that these are the words of Peter in the New Testament, writing about and to the people of Asia Minor, who were predominantly Gentile Christians. Peter, besides assuring them of their chosen nature, also reminds them of their sublime responsibility to carry forward the mission of the chosen people, which is to make the good God known and loved. Father Mermier wrote on one occasion to Father Joseph Laverelle, one of the first six men to be sent to India, "The first condition of a missionary is to have a lofty idea of this vocation, to value it above everything, considering all the rest, all other occupations as nothing, as mud, as dung, meditating and contemplating Jesus Christ, the sovereign missionary of the apostles." Father Mermier not only was busy counseling, instructing, and admonishing, he above all outlived himself in order to be for each one a living model of all priestly virtues, like a brilliant torch to guide them in the exalted paths of evangelical perfection. You and I are called to be a beacon of light, not lit up high on the mountain or on the rooftops for all the world to see, but people of essence burning within ourselves with zeal and enthusiasm, eagerness and fervor, passion and commitment. In fact, our words can speak for themselves, and our action can show forth by itself. We do not need to make an extra effort, simply because we are not advancing our own agenda, but the plans, designs, and programs of God.